I'm Frank Four, and delighted to be here to do this panel. Gabe has been a colleague of mine for a long time. He started, he did a stint as a special correspondent for The New Republic, where I got to see firsthand how he reported. In fact, the first time I got to see Gabe's reporting was I was about to become, I was about to get my current job, which is editing the magazine. And I'd gone way out of my way to try to keep the news secret. And we had some deal with the New York Times where it was supposed to be embargoed. But Gabe, who is an indefatigable reporter, got wind of this. And he started to systematically call everybody in the New Republic office. And he started at the top of the masthead, worked his way through the middle of the masthead, then started calling interns and assistants, and he called, I think, everybody in the office, and I instructed everybody not to talk to this Gabe Sherman guy, because I have my own inner Roger Ailes wanting to keep this guy away, and he finally got the one guy in the office who I hadn't actually told, that proved to be the most effective way of getting him off the scent. But I'm really, as somebody who's been your editor in the past, just really proud of this book. I think it's an incredible achievement. It's one of the, enters the pantheon of media books that really transcends media. That it's about our times, it's about our politics, it's about our culture. And we're also joined today by Amy Mitchell, who's with Pew's Journalism Project. I think you come across a lot of data. You trade in data. It's your stock and trade. And I think there's a way in which you can take some of Gabe's assertions and his broad historical analysis and apply some empirical rigor to his theses to see if they pan out. So Gabe, one place to start is, I mean, I think one of the things that your book does is it tries to actually, in addition to telling this story, it's telling a history. And you're kind of periodizing a time that this is, in a way, we've lived through this Fox era. Mm-hmm. And it's elicited a whole debate about whether liberals, in particular, should pay so much attention to Fox News, whether they're just giving Roger Ailes exactly what they want. And part of this is that is a sense that maybe Fox News is over, that we're actually exiting this period where Ailes and Fox have mm-hmm. exerted outsized influence in our society. What's your sense of this? Where are we mm-hmm. in the broad trajectory of Fox? Is it at the peak of its powers? Is it in decline?
I think that's a great question. And my book attempts to trace that arc. And I think now, in the year 2014, Fox is in a state of terminal decline. You know, where that endpoint is we can't predict. But you know, to understand Roger Ailes' life, you have to see it through the prism of his start in politics, which was working on Richard Nixon's 1968 presidential campaign. And it was that coalition of voters that Nixon assembled that Ailes has spent his career maintaining that coalition, the famous silent majority, the white middle class heartland coalition that were the Reagan Democrats that voted for George H.W. Bush, that Fox has really appealed to. And what's so interesting is that it's kind of an actuarial game at this point. Fox's audience has continued to get older. The median age of the viewer has crept up. And so, you know, that audience is still there. It's a very loyal audience, but it's not a growing audience. And so I think in the underlying demographics that Ailes knows how to reach and program to with like wedge issues of class, race, geography, that coalition is changing. And we don't know quite what will rise up behind it, but I think that the power to use media to speak to that audience is definitely on the way down.
Does Ailes share that analysis? Does he know that, I mean, is he looking at those actuarial tables and thinking, my coalition of viewers is graying, and or does he not worry about that because his time horizon is...
Well, I think what's so interesting is that my book attempts to tell this personal story of him as an American figure. And the end of my book really shows a portrait of a man who's kind of raging against the night. I mean, he's seeing the America that he knew and he understood and he thrived in changing, and it's manifesting itself through a lot of anger. If you watch Fox's programming since 2008, the channel has become even more angry as it's become more of a manifestation of Ailes' worldview. The checks and the balances that existed inside the network for much of the first 10 years of its history have kind of unleashed themselves. So Ailes is now sort of, it's purely a reflection of his worldview, and it's an angry worldview because he sees the America of, you know, the mid-century 1950s America that he grew up in, you know, where white Christian men were the dominant voice in American politics, changing. And so I don't know if he connects it to this, you know, this idea that his audience is aging out, but he sees it almost as a threat to the America that he actually said this, that he thinks he's saving the Republic. He sees Fox News as a mission to save America. And that, I think, ties into
Let's just disaggregate a couple of things there. One is, one way in which Ailes has been extremely successful is as creating a very, very lucrative, profitable enterprise. And to what extent in his worldview is he able to separate, does he separate commerce and politics? Is he, you know, is he putting on, you know, he's able to manufacture a lot of outrage. To what extent do you think in his own head he knows he's manufacturing stuff and he's putting on a show? Mm-hmm. To what extent is this all just kind of a perfect confluence of commerce and politics, where his angry, resentful worldview just happens to be to make for very watchable television?
I think the profits are what have given him political power. Without the profits, he would not have the editorial independence within Rupert Murdoch's media empire to program the channel as he sees fit. So the money gives him a power base that he can then leverage for his own ends. And what I think is so interesting is that he will at times manufacture storylines. I tell a wonderful story in the book about the war on Christmas, which, you know, has become an annual Fox News tradition. And Ailes' brother told me in an interview that Ailes basically looked out at America and he said, you know, the country's 90, you know, a vast majority celebrates Christmas, so I'm going to make Fox the pro-Christmas channel, and I'll let the other networks fight over the scraps. And so that's a marketing plan. I mean, literally, he was like finding a demographic, and he was coming up with programming to reach it. But that manufactured controversy then gives him real political power to advance issues that he cares about, which are, you know, Middle East foreign policy, entitlement spending, environmental regulation.
But he also believes that you had another funny anecdote about his Christmas at his child's school.
Yeah, so he
can tell the story. Oh, that's a good one.
Well, so exactly, this gets at the wonderful complexity of Ailes as a character. So on the one hand, he does a crass programming strategy, which manufactures the war on Christmas. But on the other hand, he actually does believe that Christmas is this American tradition under siege. And he went to his son's private school and had a row with the headmaster because they no longer could display Christmas trees. And Ailes is telling they could only display friendship trees. And so Ailes went to a meeting at the school, and as he was leaving, he grabbed a crayon and he scrawled on the wall, "Merry Christmas." And his wife was like, "What are you doing?" And he's like, "Oh, screw him." And so he was like literally defacing the school's wall in the hallway because he felt like he needed to make a statement. So I think that gets at this heart of how he really is a true believer, but then he's also a canny showman. And he knows how to leverage his true beliefs into these spectacles.
One last question, before I turn to Amy, to see if we can test some of your sense of history here with some data, but. How does somebody, I mean, this is like the, maybe a transcendent question for people who hold a worldview similar to Ailes, but, you know, how does somebody, he's so powerful, yet still so resentful about kind of being disempowered as, you know, a white Christian male from small town America, how does he reconcile that in his own head? Does he have any? I mean, he, you know, you spend all this time with him. Does he acknowledge that tension? Is it an important tension even?
I think it's, you know, it's the core to his identity it's, you know, the end of my book really explores a lot of the contradictions. I try to step back and explore the contradictions of his character and the empire he's built. And, you know, he fashions himself as a scrapper from a flyover state. And yet he has a regular table at the Four Seasons restaurant in Midtown Manhattan. He, you know, says he never cares about going to cocktail parties, and yet, you know, Barbara Walters and Henry Kissinger are some of his closest friends. So it's this duality between needing to feel persecuted, but also being the consummate insider. And that's why my book sees so many echoes to Richard Nixon. Ailes, there's so many echoes of Richard Nixon and Roger Ailes. And it is interesting that his formative career experience as a 27-year-old was working for Nixon, because he imbibed that worldview of being persecuted by the insiders and yet desperately kind of seeking out that confirmation of that you are an insider. And so I feel like you can't understand Ailes. He is so powerful, and yet he needs the world to feel like he's being held down.
So Amy, do you, so Gabe started off basically saying that he saw Fox on the way down. Do you think that, do the numbers bear that out? Or is Fox as powerful as it ever was?
Well, if you look at the, you know, the straight audience numbers, the last few years have not been great for cable news in general. Fox, you know, first of all, has more audience than MSNBC, CNN, and HLN combined, still at this point. But 2013, overall, the three cables are down in primetime 11%. Fox is down 6%. MSNBC was down 24%. CNN was in between. The election year was not a great year audience-wise for cable either. Fox was flat in prime time. MSNBC had a little bump. Overall, there was only about a 3% rise. It's a small audience, so you can pair that 1.7 million that Fox has on average for prime time, you know, to 20 million, roughly, that are watching a network evening newscast. So it is a small audience. There are, though, other measures to consider when it comes to the impact that those audience members have. They are a very engaged audience. And it's become much more politically divided. So if you look at just the ideological makeup, the party IDs, self-described, of these audiences from 2000 to 2012, you've got 10 percentage point increase in Republicans on Fox, 10 percentage points decrease on the Dem side, so that you now have twice as much of their audience describing themselves as Republican and Democrats. MSNBC has even gone further, where they now have more than three times their audience that's describing as Democrats. The time that is spent with cable news, for those of you, far exceeds the time that's spent with local or network evening news. So the engagement, even if it's a small group, the question is, what happens to those messages that comes through in that content? Because one of the other things that we look at is what's in the content itself. Yeah. And here you can see the degree to which consumers, particularly if you look at cable, get a very different sense of what's important that day, the important news events of the day, so agenda setting, as well as what to think of those events.
Does the data, so, if you're a liberal MSNBC watcher, you assume that you assume very proudly that the quality of the information that you're getting on that network is superior to the quality of the information that conservatives are getting from Fox, and I'm sure you know. And the same is the reverse is also true. What qualitatively does the data show are the differences between the two networks? Should you know, if you look at it from where you sit, are they essentially equivalents in the way that they operate when you apply your metrics to disaggregate?
Well, there's more. I mean, there's more opinion on MSNBC primetime at this point. If that's what we're getting at. But if you look at they're both making choices about agenda. If you look at coverage of the typhoon story versus Obama. Care, which happened the same week, the typhoon disaster. You had 80 times as much coverage on Fox of the healthcare story as you did of typhoon. You had four times as much on MSNBC. Early 2007, Fox covered to very, very small degree the debate over Iraq, which MSNBC and CNN covered to a far greater degree. So that choice about what to put on the air, what to talk about, is one that has an influence in terms of, you know, what people are hearing, what messages are getting.
I want to pick up on one point because it connects to this scene that I was captivated by in my book, which explores the moment that the statue of Saddam Hussein came down in central Baghdad. Is, you know, weeks into the war, it looked like, you know, the American forces were marching to topple the regime. And inside Fox and all the networks, but Fox really pushed this, they made that image of the statue coming down like the fall of the Berlin Wall. And I interviewed producers who were in the control room, and they were literally trying to make this image this larger message about the American victory in Iraq. And after that statue came down, Fox producers made a conscious decision to limit the coverage of the war, the actual amount of time spent on covering the war, even though American casualties, the numbers continued to creep up, the volume of coverage came down because it fit this narrative that they were building. Literally, they were, you know, programming it like movie directors, that this was the narrative that the Americans were marching into Baghdad and the war had this moment of victory and then, you know, it was going to wrap up. But actually, as we know, the messy reality on the ground was that the insurgency was just beginning. And so I think you see in the...
When you went and you had those conversations with those producers, how did they explain it? Did they explain that they were doing it because victory rated well? Or were they explaining it because they had they wanted the American people to feel good about a war that they similarly believed in?
What I think is so fascinating is the complexity of that. So you have the true believers around Ailes who are real, you know, conservative believers, ideologues, and they believed in the American mission. But then you have a lot of producers who are down in the mid-level at Fox who are just TV guys, and they know what's good television. And what's good television is essentially an action movie where, you know, the Americans are G.I. Joe and they're kicking butt. And so you have that mix of commerce and partisanship that came together to make the war this incredibly seductive story for Fox's audience. And that's, you know, from 2001, from 9/11 through, you know, 05, you know, that's when Fox's audience exploded.
Right.
And they passed CNN in 2002 and they never looked back. But it was really the war where I think Fox's audience found this type of programming that spoke to them. You know, Fox referred to the American troops as our troops. It was this notion of they were speaking for the home team. It was almost like an NFL pregame show where the announcers were building up the audience before the game.
Amy, do you find that that the viewers of these channels respond to different sets of news? That when news is optimistic about certain things, that they tune in more. When there's pessimism about the issues that they care about, they tune out.
Well, I think one of the other questions that centers around that is to what degree are the messages from the campaigns or the candidates themselves getting into those channels and then getting into the very engaged audiences and then getting beyond that. Because at the same time that we've seen this polarization occur in the audiences, the two cable audiences, we're seeing it occur across the country in the electorate. I mean, the political divide that we're seeing in the electorate has grown tremendously over the last 25 years, in particular since 2000. But so one of the things that we've seen also is that in the conversations around the last two presidential campaigns, both MSNBC and Fox are focusing far more on delivering the negative messages about the opposing candidate than they are focusing on their own candidate at all. But driving in that negative messages, which is more and more coming directly from the mouths of the campaigns and the surrogates. The degree to which the journalistic voices in there has decreased 50% between 2000 and 2012 across the media.
Gabe, you just following you on Twitter over the course of the last few years, seemed like you were watching Fox News almost 24 hours a day.
I need to apologize to my wife, who's in the audience, who was subjected to a lot of that viewing.
Do you view Fox and MSNBC as essentially equivalents, or do you think that Fox is, you know, the way that Fox operates is journalistically, or
I think Fox is a much more powerful media platform platform than MSNBC, which is a testament to Ailes' talents as both a political strategist and a television producer. You know, I think it's important to step back. For much of Fox's history, the notion of fair and balanced for a lot of the journalism and political establishment really was something that was hotly debated, but it was actually debated. You know, Fox will say, you know, we have liberal voices on Fox. They will say that there was the split between opinion and news. You know, opinion was in primetime, news was during the day. And you know, prior to 2008 and 2009, you know, you could actually have somewhat of a debate about that. I think MSNBC, the difference is that they have decided to go all in as pure progressive liberal programming, you know, beyond some voices like Joe Scarborough in the morning. It really is just Democratic TV. Whereas Ailes realized that his audience did not just want red meat. They wanted to see the conflict. They wanted to see liberals, you know, throwing some bones to conservatives to chew on. And so that made it a much more powerful platform because it wasn't strictly propaganda in the eyes of its audience. It really was viewed by millions of people as news. And so I think that's what the difference is. MSNBC is really just speaking to a progressive audience. It's kind of a progressive echo chamber. Whereas Fox really tried to say, we're trying to be a news network, no different than the New York Times, no different than CNN.
Well, one of the other places where you can see the power being exerted is in license fees arrangements. I mean, Fox has come down very, very, very hard on demanding very high license fees from the carriers, and have succeeded in doing so. And so now the cost for Fox is far greater than the cost for either CNN or MSNBC. But it's sort of seeing it from a business standpoint, feeling the power that the corporation senses they can put forward, and demanding that revenue come through.
Gabe, just talk about the process of reporting this book. I mean, the stories in the book about your reporting it are kind of astonishing. That they you know, Ailes really desperately did not want you to do this book, and he went to great lengths to try to shut you down. And so you tried to report it, like you reported on at the New Republic, where you went down the masthead and you tried to call everybody until you got people to talk to you on the phone. But you know, how does it reflect the Fox? Their method.
I think, you know, one of the big revelations of the book is that you know, the reporting validates the idea that Fox is a political organization that has journalists working there. And Ailes built the network on the culture of a political campaign where secrecy is paramount, leaks are ruthlessly punished, there is a daily message of the day, you know, just the way a campaign war room would say, this is the message we're pushing of the day. That's the way Fox operates. And so a reporter like me who tries to paint a nuanced, measured picture, get a lot of voices, talk to everyone, assemble and reconstruct this complicated world is a direct threat to that that desire for control. So it was the most challenging reporting assignment of my career. Layered on top of that is the fact that Ailes, as a leader, is terrifying to his executives. I mean, the level of fear he inspires in the people who work for him made it such that people would only meet me in diners. Some people never didn't want to talk to me on the phone. I mean, there was kind of this game of cloak and dagger that the reporting required that I had never experienced before. You know, most people think covering the media, you know, we're in the media, we're used to talking to journalists. Fox is a whole separate world.
Do you think that they were right to fear repercussions from Ailes?
You know, I think perception is reality, but I think Ailes has demonstrated a willingness to play hardball in a way that most people don't associate with regular corporations. You know, he has had people followed by private investigators. I heard he had me followed by a private investigator, and I pity that soul because I'm so boring that I can just imagine some PI sitting, you know, in his car idling, being like, God, why am I here? but yeah, I think Ailes has, you know, he's demonstrated violence in his career. You know, there's a scene in my book that took place during Rudy Giuliani's 1989 mayoral campaign in New York City, in which some AIDS activists disrupted a Giuliani fundraiser. and Ailes jumped into the protest and started beating up one of the protesters. He's gotten in fistfights in the office. He threw a water bottle at one of his top lieutenants. He said he missed him on purpose. Who knows if that's true. So I think, you know, he is this larger-than-life figure.
You could have taken him.
Yeah. Well, I think now, you know, I think he's... So I think that, you know, this kind of charismatic, larger-than-life aspect to him engenders fear. And I think whether it's validated or not, the fact is people who work for him are scared of him.
All right. Well, why don't we actually, open it up to some questions? Yeah.
That's a great question. I think the answer is no. You know, Roger Ailes, it's important to step back for a second. You know, Roger Ailes ended up working for Murdoch because he had a complete career implosion at NBC, where he was working from 1993 to beginning of 96. He did not fit into the corporate culture of NBC. He was like a caged animal. I mean, he was investigated by the HR department for allegedly making an anti-Semitic remark. He just was completely out of sorts in a corporate environment. So when Murdoch hired him, he did two things for Roger Ailes. He gave him capital. Murdoch spent hundreds of millions of dollars literally putting Fox News onto cable systems, buying access to cable systems, and he gave Ailes freedom to be Ailes. You know, News Corporation, Murdoch's company, is famous for having this pirate-like culture, right, where these larger-than-life characters can just be themselves as long as they produce profits. There's really no kind of standards and practices that would keep them in check. And so really it was this ultimate marriage of convenience where Murdoch gave Ailes both the freedom and the resources to create this thing.
Talk a little bit about the very interesting psychology of that relationship.
I say it's codependent because they... are not particularly close personally. Their relationship has ebbed and flowed through the years. You know, for example, Rupert Murdoch is very close with Robert Thompson, who was his handpicked editor of the Wall Street Journal. They vacation together. They're close personal friends. Ailes and Murdoch are not close personally, but they both need each other. And the number one thing Murdoch needs from Ailes are the profits, because at this point, Fox News is the profit engine of Murdoch's empire. Without Fox News, everything else kind of doesn't work because Fox is the number one reliable source of earnings every single year. And so even though Ailes has presented Murdoch with problems, Murdoch notably cozied up to Obama in 2008. There were intimations that the Murdoch empire was going to become more centrist. Murdoch's kids have feuded with Ailes through the years. There's kind of been these flashpoints. Mm-hmm. But every time there's a flashpoint, Ailes flexes his corporate muscle and Murdoch backs off and says, you know what, Roger, you can have Fox, you can do your thing. And so I think it's this interesting tension in their relationship where even when they know there's been conflict between the two men, they at the end of the day, they can't survive without each other.
Does Murdoch respond to anybody else in that sort of way? Or is it really Ailes the only person in his universe who can so consistently make him bend?
I think Ailes is the only person who over time has demonstrated this ability to challenge him. I mean, Judith Regan was a famously difficult person. She got fired from News Corp. You know, editors, Murdoch has discharged editors at will through the years. You know, Ailes is the one corporate executive who has survived, and I think it's a testament to the money. The money is just too good.
Is there anything else in the history of, does any of this resonate in other analogs in the history of media that you can think of? Are there?
I mean, if you think way, way back to the beginning of, you know, the journalism in this country where you had your yellow newspapers and politically driven newspapers, certainly, you know, the degree to which there were newspapers built around political ideology and that's how people got their news. You know, the newspapers then went, you know, very far in a different direction in terms of trying to have a broad agenda, saying we are trying to come at this with as equal sense of viewpoints as possible. So absolutely, but this certainly, you know, this speaks to a broader question about what's happening in our country today, and it's actually an area of research at the Pew Research Center is just launching a very big project to look at polarization and the degree to which it's occurring, degree to which it's not occurring, what kind of things are connected and not connected, including media choice. Mm-hmm. And to what degree are individuals' choice of media and segmentation along media lines, whether it's their cable viewing or their circles in social media or the feeds that they get inside Twitter or any of these others, to what degree is that creating different identities inside this country around what's happening and political orientation?
Yes.
Hello, my name is Oliver Grimm. I'm the correspondent with an Austrian newspaper here in DC called Die Presse. In your book, at one point you quote Murdoch saying that I think the values of those who report the news aren't the same ones as the values of the people who receive the news. And I think this is also kind of a point made in Jill Lepore's article about your book in The New Yorker. So there's apparently for many people a big gap between what we as journalists consider newsworthy and interesting and what they in their lives consider important. Do you think that gap still exists, as it did at the time when you know, Fox News became great 10, 15 years ago? And what does that mean, given that Fox, I think the average viewer is 68, mm-hmm. so they're pretty old. They don't really have a very well-functioning online strategy, but that gap still exists, I think, for many people, not necessarily for us. Mm-hmm. So who will take over the sort of the torch of Ailes once he doesn't do that?
Two really good questions. I think, if I can maybe answer your first point, I think it's interesting to look at the founding DNA, the culture of Fox when Ailes founded it in 1996. And he brought with him to Fox his mentor, a man named Chet Collier, who was a longtime television executive, came out of the talk show world. Daytime TV was Chet Collier's specialty. And there was a saying that Collier pushed around Fox News where he said, people don't want to be informed, they want to feel informed. And I think that really speaks to the culture of Fox News and also cable news more broadly, is this notion of how to create programming that looks and sounds and feels like news, but ultimately is appealing to an audience on a sort of a deeper emotional level, speaking to their cultural affinities. And for Fox's case, it's a heartland and a conservative audience. And so as Fox's audience has grown older, you know, we've talked about this, the programming has become more conservative. You know, Fox from 2000 to 2012 has become more conservative as its audience has grown more conservative and older.
And vice versa at MSNBC, yeah. as it's carved out its niche, its niche as a counter to that. And you know, part of what we're seeing is the degree to which there are you know, audiences that are looking to hear particular messages, looking to reinforce the way they see things. And if you look at even just the makeup of the programming, so we think about reported packages versus on-air interviews versus, you know, live reporting, one of the things that we looked at in the cable stream is that mix. And over a six-year period, you see a huge increase across the board at these cable stations of the reliance on scheduled interviews. So on-air interviews, as opposed to going out and doing reported packages. Now, there can be a number of influences into making that decision, but it also gives you more control. You schedule the guest in advance. You kind of know their sensibilities. You know what they're going to say. It takes less work. So from a, you know, reporting power perspective, there's a difference as well. But it clearly has been a shift in terms of the dynamic of what consumers are getting.
Well, one thing that's interesting to me is what, the point that you're making in the ways in which the politics of Fox are very much cultural politics. That something like the war on Christmas is not really, I mean, it's ridiculously disassociated, I think, from reality, but also ridiculously dissociated from policy and politics as we kind of understand it. And one thing I've been told by Republicans is that in DC, they're just as likely to watch MSNBC as they are to watch Fox, because Fox has so little to do with what's happening here, and MSNBC is so much more engaged with debates in Congress and happenings in the White House and foreign policy. So just to, like, on the basis of being informed about the world, Fox is kind of off pursuing these pseudo narratives that they pursue that really they're political, but not political in any sort of conventional sense of political journalism.
Well, I think what's so interesting is that there are times where those narratives do align with the political system, like on big stories like healthcare, right. Iraq. But Ailes, you know, if he can't find the big story that resonates with his audience, then they'll make up stories. You know, Fox was pushing the notion of Obama's czars for a while. That was right. A huge storyline that we were having this sort of extra constitutional authority being invested in these policy heads. That was a huge story on Fox, wasn't a big story elsewhere in the media, and wasn't that connected to what was actually happening in Washington. So there are moments where Fox's the big story that they're pushing will intersect with the Washington conversation, but Fox is, and I write in my book, it can be its own self-contained universe. There is a whole conversation happening on Fox News, but not only, also in conservative radio online. That is, it's just literally, it's not, if you had a Venn diagram, there wouldn't be that much overlap with what is happening in the mainstream.
Right. Well, one of the, you know, if you think back to, again, in 2007, when the earlier immigration bill was up for passage, and that was when conservative talk show hosts, which were both radio and television, which included Lou Dobbs at the time on CNN, publicly said, we're going to defeat this bill. You know, we're taking it upon ourselves to defeat this bill. And we looked at the coverage the last, you know, days, you know, a couple of weeks before the bill got killed. And indeed, it was by far the number one topic across these conservative talk show hosts, across the media overall that we studied, it was fourth. And you know, to a much smaller percentage of the coverage overall.
Yes.
I was hoping you could talk a little bit more about how influential Fox News actually is in American politics. How much is it changing electoral outcomes? How much is it changing the agenda in Washington? You hear two narratives. For example, Fox News sort of elevated the status of the Tea Party and made it a major movement in America, yet you also hear a narrative about Roger Ailes desperately wanting to elect a president in 2012, and he failed.
Well, I think what I explore in the book through the reporting is that Fox, throughout the 2000s, really, both those goals were in sync. Both the ratings and the politics that Fox was putting on the screen was advancing the interests of the Bush White House. And the apex, the real peak of Fox's political power to elect the president, to sort of shape the macro direction of our country, was really around 2005 and 2006. There's a party I describe in the book that took place at Cafe Milano, where Fox News was celebrating the 10-year anniversary of Fox News Sunday, its Meet the Press-style show. And everyone in Washington turned out. It was literally, as one person very close to Ailes told me, you know, they all came to kiss the ring because Fox had revolutionized, you know, Republican, you know, Karl Rove was talking about the enduring Republican mm-hmm. majority. It looked like we were at the dawn of a new age, and then Hurricane Katrina happened, and the fortune of the Bush White House spiraled out of control. But what I'm trying to say is that now Fox has its audience, you know, the viewers, like you've talked about, are so loyal, but it's really a base audience. You know, Fox's power, I think, is really best viewed through the prism of midterm elections. And in 2010, the Tea Party that Ailes nurtured helped usher in a huge swing in Congress, the biggest, I believe, since 1948. Mm-hmm. But that's a base audience. They can't appeal beyond that to a national majority. So I think now, I think Fox's power as a national voice will continue to wane. That said, it's like we've talked about the polarization in Congress. The districts are so gerrymandered that, you know, Fox News will still get Republican voters to turn out for congressional seats. But I don't think, if 2012 is an indicator, that they can appeal beyond that to a national majority.
To what extent do they try to goad liberals? I mean, something like the White Santa controversy that happened. It seems like some of the gaffes, some of the controversies that they generate, like, aren't even intended to rile their own base. They're intended more to just give something for people on Twitter and the liberal blogosphere and MSNBC to get exercise.
They can't get enough of it. I mean, look at what happened after President Obama told David Remnick of The New Yorker in a recent interview that Fox News was responsible for distorting his image to the Republican base. You know, Megyn Kelly took those comments and did an entire segment with Charles Krauthammer about the president being all riled up about Fox News. I mean, they love it when they are the persecuted ones, when liberals are outraged about Fox. It gives them free content. I mean, they can't get enough of it.
Yes, in the back.
I don't know who it is.
Yeah, why don't you ahead?
Ibrahim Mukman with Mukman and Associates. I'm curious as to Ailes and his leadership's evolution. I grew up doing segregation in the South, and one of the things I saw is some of the people who were that white majority, as they got older, it seems like some of them started changing. I think about George Wallace and other people. So is there a shift? How do they rationalize segregation and stuff in, trying to go back to the good old days in the 50s when that was persecution and hell for a lot of people in this country?
I think Ailes is interesting on the race issue. I'll just talk a little bit about his experience. Came out of the daytime TV world in the 1960s. He was born in 1940, so he came of age at a time when civil rights was becoming a national issue. And I think he is, he's interesting that he put a lot of civil rights leaders on his show, the Mike Douglas Show, when he was a producer. So he knows that, I think he felt on certain issues that he was on board with civil rights, but also as a political issue, he knew, as Nixon did, that you have to talk about it in ways that doesn't alienate your audience, and that's why Fox.
Nixon kind of deliberately. I mean, he had a Southern strategy,
yeah.
And he designed his politics in order to kind of stoke racial resentments. If not by explicitly defending.
Yeah.
Jim Crow, but by talking about crime.
I think Fox it does that in its own way by, elevating stories. Bill O'Reilly went on a big campaign when there was that crime in Norfolk, Virginia, where he made it a black-on-white crime. So Fox will cover things from the other perspective. If MSNBC is talking about a Trayvon Martin case, Fox will elevate a black on a white case to make it, sort of have an equivalency in the media conversation. So that's where I think you see some of the old tensions from the civil rights era playing out in our national media conversation. I mean, I think the Black Santa debate was obviously touched on that. And I think going back to the 2008 election, Fox was pushing this notion of the new Black Panther Party, that there was unreported, the Justice Department would refuse to take up a civil rights crime against a black group because they were trying to curry favor with that constituency. Now, I think that appeals to Fox's audience that grew up at a time when busing and segregation was a big issue.
Well, Ailes is also, though, he understands, to an extent, demographic weakness in that he's kind of flirted with the idea of doing more to reach out to a Latino audience. I mean, that he's, right?
He's tried. I think what's so interesting is that Ailes, his political agenda tells him to do is often at odds with his own personal politics. And I tell the story in the book about how in public he talked about Fox's need to moderate on immigration. And yet in private, his view is that the US should send Navy SEALs to the border to secure the border with orders to shoot people coming across. Now, I don't think Latino groups would find that immigration policy that palatable. But Ailes will talk about the Republican Party's need to win Latino voters, but he can't square that with his desire to seal off the United States from the southern border.
Amy, have you looked at the
the Hispanic population is huge and growing in this country. It is going to be a major part of the electorate and is a major issue for the Republican Party to figure out if they want to have a majority vote, because that the Hispanic population is growing. There are more native born than in the past. They're more English speaking in the past, or they're feeling connected to this electorate, and will be a very, very powerful voting base.
Have you seen data that looks at the different ways in which the networks, the different terminology the networks use about race when they talk about it, or the different amount of attention that they devote to some of these?
We have not. We did a study a while back that looked at Hispanic-oriented media versus right. U.S. media in general, and there were great differences in terms of the orientation there, but not within the U.S. media.
All right. Yes.
Thank you. My name is James. I'm a scholar of journalism with the Reporter Foundation. My question is about the philosophy behind Fox News or whatever the network overall management or the establishment. But you can see that they house Sarah Palin, Mike Huckabee, and the former speaker Gingrich. But these are losers. So what's the philosophy behind them backing these losers? Do they still have real audience? And at the same time, my research, and actually just a couple of weeks ago, a couple of years ago, during the presidential election, there's a report said that the audience, if you listen or watch the Fox News for 6 months or longer, your brain power will be shrinking. So from your research during the book,
Gabe, how much has your brain power shrunk over the course of?
Thank you very much.
I've noticed some diminishment.
I can answer the first point. I'd have to look
your
at
your wife
the,
can answer. This.
Yeah, but I'd be happy to read. I'd like to see that report. Maybe I can after you can give me a link and I'll take a look at it. But I think Ailes. What's so interesting is that those three people you spoke about are in their own way. They're all compelling television performers. And Ailes looks first and foremost for people who make good television, which is sometimes not helpful for the Republican Party, for the brand of the party. But after 2008, he was blown away, like many conservatives were, with Sarah Palin's convention speech and race to hire her because she was this magnetic television personality. And so I think the people that he elevates on Fox are first and foremost have to be TV people. And whether they're political winners is secondary.
Have you, as one of the most diehard Fox watchers, what is there? Are there characters on there, just as a matter of pure television, characters or shows there that you, as kind of even neutral, hardened journalist, end up watching and saying, I can't turn away. This is such awesome television.
Well, in its own special way. Fox and Friends has a place in my heart. It is the quintessential Fox News show. It is, and for one main reason, because it is essentially Roger Ailes' show. He's kind of the unofficial executive producer of the show. He picked Steve Doocy, who used to in the 90s host an NBC syndicated show called House Party, which I think tells you kind of everything you need to know about Fox and Friends.
Washingtonians know Steve Doocy from way back.
Yes, he's been a journeyman television personality. And it kind of gets at everything that is irresistible about Fox. It's a spectacle. You never quite know, watching Fox and Friends, what's going to happen. I mean, I think it's interesting to point out when...
Do you have a favorite segment? Is there one moment you just... If you could watch it over and over again?
I love the moment when they... They do the talking points because it is the cheery morning show format, and they sit and the three hosts exchange the most vitriolic right-wing talking points, but they do it with that morning show smile, and it's that dissonance that you just can't turn away. And I think it's interesting to point out that when Glenn Beck made his famous comment that Obama has a deep-seated hatred for white people, that was during a Fox and Friends interview. They elicited that. He could sort of sense the Fox id on the set and drew that out of him.
Yes.
So Roger Ailes' career is basically as a partisan propagandist before he got back into media. And as part of, he's sort of a spinmeister trying to accept the, get the Republican message to be accepted as truth. The most important aspect of spin is to get it accepted as not as spin, as legitimacy. And with Roger Ailes' determination to constantly say that Fox News is fair and balanced, I think just a few weeks ago he was talking about it, we are the most objective news network, and he goes about that. How much of that is his need for spin to get his the concept of Fox News and what they do as legitimate? How much is it that he actually truly believes it and just wants to be legitimized as a pure news source?
Well, I can't get in his head, so I don't want to answer whether he truly believes it. But I can tell you what he's talked about, how important that is. And I think the fair and balanced mantra was central to Fox News' success. Without it, it likely would have failed. And Ailes himself had said, when he launched Fox News, that there had been, by his count, four failures of a right-wing TV network. They tried to do it. It got ghettoized as right-wing. It wasn't taken seriously by the establishment. They couldn't get kind of legitimacy. So to position Fox as something that it wasn't, that it was objective, that it was fair and balanced, was central to this idea of it being taken as a legitimate news source. They have a seat, as right as we speak, in the White House briefing room. They're sitting there alongside the New York Times, the Washington Post, the Associated Press. I mean, Fox, it's one of the most masterful sales jobs in American history, that for 17 years until recently, that fiction is kind of, it's undeniable that it is a conservative news network. It's Roger Ailes' megaphone. But for much of Fox's history, fair and balanced, if you asked most people beyond, the sort of far progressive left, they would say, yeah, they got some conservatives, but they give both sides. So it was central to that selling, that legitimacy.
Hannity wouldn't have been successful if he didn't have Combs.
And I think, the idea that it was an equal fight, I mean, I would love, I didn't get to interview Alan Combs, I would love to interview him now just to get his take of what it was like to, he was set up to fail every night, and, what that experience was like for him.
Yeah. Yes.
Michelle Manat with Meridian International Center. Congratulations on the book and on your remarkable media tour for the book. I've heard you multiple times. I wondered if you could tell us a little bit about how he looks at women in America, women as the audience, mm-hmm. the issues that are around women, women of all ages, mm-hmm. and what women have had influence in his life mm-hmm. earlier and perhaps now as well. Thank you.
That's a great question. I think the women on Fox play the role of 1950s gender roles. The women on Fox are sort of hyper feminized. The makeup, the hair. Fox is you could actually speak to the specific data possibly, but it's a more of a male audience, greater than majority male than female mm-hmm. viewers. So he is programming. He's putting women on the screen that appeal to a male's idea of feminine beauty in sort of Roger Ailes' imagination.
To an older
1950s kind of man. I think the gender dynamics on Fox are, it's a male-dominated network. Roger Ailes comes out of the TV industry, which historically was a male-dominated industry. There's kind of a sordid episode in my book that I describe some episodes he had with women that were very sexist, very chauvinist. It reflects this kind of male-dominated society that he grew out of. And I think women on Fox, they're very intelligent. I'm not commenting on their intelligence, but they're there first for their beauty and to serve that role to kind of represent the feminine ideal to his audience.
What about women who had any influence on you? Classic mother, mm-hmm. sisters,
yeah,
mothers,
well, it's interesting. Roger Ailes had a very domineering mother. She was the ambitious one in his family. His father didn't go to college. Neither of his parents went to college, but his father was a very frustrated factory foreman. His mother was the one who pushed him to do acting lessons, take piano lessons. She insisted that the kids get straight A's in school. She was the overbearing, pushy one. And I think it's interesting that, Roger Ailes very quickly into his adult life, set out to get married on his own. He's married three times. He married his first wife in college. He, on the one hand, sort of idolizes or sort of upholds the traditional notion of the American family. You know, marriage is important to him. But on the other hand, you know, he's been divorced three times, you know, two times, not as to his third marriage. So it's that, you know, that there's tension there. And I think it's a very 1950s tension. You know, we now know through history that the American family wasn't this, you know, leave it to beaver image. It was underneath, it was darker, there was more of a reality there. And I think Fox captures that. On the surface, it looks, the women there serve a purpose, but underneath there is a darker reality that the women there are serving, are there to be a subservient role to the male hosts. I think one thing I want to point out is Megyn Kelly, I think, is an interesting contradiction there. You know, she is a feisty host. She will speak up and challenge the male hosts. And
she's bucked the line there.
Yeah, and I think she's done a very good job of carving out her own power center there that other female hosts haven't been able to do.
Do you have anything to add about the gender?
I mean, I would just say that it's one of the interesting things to watch in the coming years as we move towards the 2016 election is the dynamic, particularly among young people, and social issues in this country, and the degree to which young people tend to be, you know, much more liberal in their social issues, much more accepting of some of these social issues, and also the degree to which we're seeing women that much of our data has shown are taking more and more a primary role in the household, the primary breadwinner in the household. The number of households that have a woman as a primary breadwinner has increased very substantially over the last several years, both in terms of those that are single parent households, but not always. There are also a great increase in those where the dad's at home or he's not the primary breadwinner. So a real shift in dynamic there, mm-hmm. in terms of the role that the female plays, that the mom plays in the family dynamic, and how that plays out across the broader political spectrum of our country.
Kind of related question to that, Gabe, is, you know, the revolution in social mores around gay rights and gay marriage kind of penetrated every aspect of culture. How does Fox News respond to that? Have they basically given up on the issue, or are they still fighting a rearguard action against?
You know, I think the fact that there's a war on Christmas tradition, but there's not a war on marriage tradition at Fox that shows me that they'll do pockets of coverage, but institutionally it is not.
What is Ailes? Does Ailes have gay friends?
Yes, I think that's very interesting. Is that Ailes personally? He's very pro-life. I mean, abortion is a very black and white issue for him. But on gay marriage, he personally does not. You know, he has gay friends. There's gay anchors at Fox. What I think is interesting is that Ailes sort of views the world through political groups, conflict. And so he's very skeptical of gay activists. I've heard stories from people when gay interest groups have, there's one episode I reported where they met with him and he insisted on having a witness in the room because he was worried they were going to twist his words and make him seem homophobic. So he is kind of paranoid and skeptical of the politics around gay activism. But on a personal level, he has gay friends. It's not a big issue for him.
All right, let's take two more. Yeah.
I'm Fuzz Hogan. I work here. And so the future of news is the framing here, and the notion that, to some degree, the news we have now is very similar to the news from 1780 or 1800. That, to some degree, the technology of the past century is sort of changed the news in a strange way, and that we're actually now naturalizing back to a real...
Meaning more partisan.
More partisan, yeah. Much more demand-driven, not limited by technology or even regulation, yeah. Right? So project out 30 years, or 2050, sorry to do my math wrong.
Project out 30 minutes.
I think that. So demographically, Amy, and technologically, so how will the media we have now change in the next 30 years? Will it be, is there a positive trend? Is it just more of this demand-driven balkanization? What does media look like, Amy, and then Gabe?
Well, we are not in the prediction business, so I will not necessarily predict. What we do see happening with the development of technology is, first and foremost, that in all these new realms of technology, whether it's the various mobile devices, from the things you wear in your ear to the things you hold in your hand or your pocket, wear in your wrist, social media, news is a part of what people do in these spaces, and it's a pretty substantial part. I mean, again and again, when we act about activity-based, different activities in these spaces, news ranks very high up there. It functions differently in different spaces. So in some cases, people are seeking it out. In other cases, like in social media, they bump into it. They come across it. Well, it certainly, it includes civic-minded policy journalism. When we defined it in our social media surveys that we did this past fall, we talked about it as events and issues that are happening that go beyond yourself and your family and friends. So it does include entertainment. And then when we go through the list of topics, entertainment's up there, but information about my local community is very, very high. It's second. National events is very high up there, too. So there's a pretty wide mix of the kind of things. Most people get news across at least six different topics in these spaces. So news is a part. That's, in terms of looking at it from a civic engagement, that's a good thing in terms of the place for news in this country. Technology companies are realizing that news is in these spaces, so they're reaching out, whether it's Facebook or Twitter or Google, creating tools for journalists to use. We see a lot of content tech organizations that are now moving into wanting to understand and in some cases do original reporting because news is a part of what people do in these spaces. So news is likely to be a part of the dynamic as technology moves ahead. One of the other questions, though, is who's going to be the influencer of the news that any individual gets? And to what degree are we moving into areas where there is a much narrower mix of the kind of information that one person gets from their circle of friends to their technologies? That's an area where there's still a lot of learning to be done and is something we're going to be digging into this year.
Sorry, I'm hiding in the back. Hadass Gold from Politico. Nice to see you in person, Gabe. I wanted to ask you, Gabe, about the reaction to your book since you've published it for everything. I know you talked about Maslin yesterday on WNYC, so if you wanted to mention that, but also whether that surprised you, all the different reviews, how people are now saying that the New York Times bestseller list is skewed and you're not actually number 9 and all of these things. Does this surprise you? Do you think it's coming from the Ailes War Room? What do you think it says about how we all view Fox News, the fact that your book's been out for a couple weeks now and people are still obsessing over it and writing articles about it every week?
Well, I'll say a few things. I'm thrilled that people are in debating and arguing and engaging with the work. As a reporter, that's what you want. I want to start conversations. I hope what I report reveals things in a new light and people can argue with it. It can confirm their assumptions, challenge their assumptions. So I'm thrilled about that. As to the reviews, there have been a lot of positive reviews. The Janet Maslin review in the Times was not a positive review. I'm fine with negative reviews. I think negative reviews serve a place. I am interested that, as was reported by Gawker, a close personal friend of hers, Peter Boyer, who was personally hired by Roger Ailes, is written about very critically in my book. I do a lot of hard reporting about his relationship with Ailes and his coverage of Ailes as a journalist before he was hired. But that's a question for the New York Times to answer about whether she should have disclosed her friendship, whether they talked about the review, and hopefully the Times will address it, but that's a question for the Times. As for the pushback, I think it's so interesting that the coverage of my book was treated like a political campaign. And I was, as a reporter, thrust into the unconventional position of being the story, not reporting the story. And in the 3 years I spent working on this book, for a lot of that time, Ailes, through surrogates, mainly in conservative media, portrayed me as a Soros-backed attack dog, on the payroll, personal payroll of George Soros. One article called me Jason Blair with steroids. I mean, they was very much very much of an effort to define me in the eyes of Ailes' audience, which actually, for my purposes as a reporter, was very revealing, because it revealed the way Ailes operates and views media. So in a certain way, it confirmed all the reporting I had done about Ailes in a way maybe he didn't intend it to.
I mean, it's an interesting phenomenon, like being on, I mean, clearly you were on the receiving end of a campaign to discredit, mm-hmm. to discredit you. And the question is then, how do you as a journalist respond? I mean, because part of the perils and the temptation is that if you have a political campaign, yeah. kind of being waged against you, which is to kind of try to reciprocate in some sort of way. Can you talk about your thinking in how you've gone about kind of processing, parrying, overlooking some of the things that have been thrown your way?
I think the best way to respond is just by doing the journalism I do. I mean, my clips, my bylines, my work speaks for itself. So Ailes created a campaign to portray me as some left-wing activist, but you know, I've covered the New York Times, I've covered Obama administration officials aggressively, so anyone who reads my work will see that I'm not that person. But to your point about what to address, you know, it was a challenge. At the one hand, I did not want to get down in the weeds and play at that political level, because I'm not in the world of politics, I'm in the world of journalism. But on the other hand, I couldn't let outright smears and distortions go unchecked, because, you know, unfortunately, we live in a world where, you know, things that wind up on Google are there for eternity. So there were certain cases where I tried to shed light on the campaign, because sunlight is the best disinfectant. And I think people could see what Ailes was doing for what it was. And I don't think it ever crossed over into the mainstream outside of the conservative echo chamber.
Do you think you think Ailes was masterminding a lot of this himself, or do you think that he was outsourcing this to?
I think it was a mix. I know there were cases where people who were doing things that he may or may not have been aware of, but he was okay with it. And I know that there were cases where he was directly involved. So, you know, one of the enduring talents Ailes has demonstrated is ability to have plausible deniability. You know, he always can say, I had nothing to do with it. And, you know, Fox is not going to release, you know, no one's going to disclose emails from him that show he was orchestrating it. So at the end of the day, it will be his word against mine. But my sources, who were, you know, oftentimes very aware of those conversations, told me that he was pushing this message, that I was somehow a Soros activist. And you could see that message then radiate out through the conservative media. And I think one last point, I think it's so interesting to see that if the conservative coverage of me in my book was a legitimate news story on the right, why has there not been any coverage of the book now that it's out? I mean, there have been just a smattering of articles about it. But, you know, Breitbart News committed more than 9,000 words to covering me in the run-up to the book's publication, and has been silent, virtually silent, since it's been out. So that, to me, shows me it's an orchestrated political campaign. It's not a legitimate news story. Because if it was newsworthy, they would continue to cover it. But somebody around Ailes or Fox has said, ignore this book, on the right. And it's working, because the National Review, the Weekly Standard, Breitbart News, Daily Caller, they have virtually ignored this book, because obviously someone very close to Ailes does not want them to cover it.
So has this this experience changed the way that you think about right-wing media? Because you seem to be saying that, you know, it's that there's.
I think they work in. I mean, there is. If you are on the right, you cannot challenge Fox. I have had people, very very qualified, high-level Republicans, say, if you are on the right and you have to sell a book, you want to get your political ideas out there, if you challenge Fox, you will be banned, and then you are virtually irrelevant in American conservative politics. And so that is why I've always wondered why, you know, I'm a nonpartisan reporter. I cover everyone aggressively, the New York Times, Fox News, no different. Why isn't there an enterprising conservative reporter at the Weekly Standard or the National Review who is aggressively covering Fox News? And it's so revealing of this fact that they view Fox as the champion of their cause, not as a legitimate institution that they should cover aggressively the same way they cover any other story. And that, to me, is a testament to Ailes' power, that he has virtually dominated and controlled the way conservatives get their message out to their audience.
Why don't we just walk off question, which is, have you gotten any sense of what Ailes thinks of the actual book? Because you obviously had a great sense of his anxiety leading up to the publication of the book. Mm-hmm. What word have you gotten about?
Well, I've heard that the general word around Fox is that it is not a topic to be discussed about in sort of official capacity. I talked to a source who spent more than an hour with Ailes, and this person said Ailes did not mention the book once. And this same source had been in conversations with Ailes where he had been apoplectic about the book and said that, you know, this book is going to ruin him and define him, and, you know, I was a subject of conversation. So I think it's almost a case, from what I've heard, that he's trying to wish it into non-existence. And that is just fascinating, that on Fox, you can, if you almost can create a reality by just not covering something. And I think it will be interesting to see if, you know, I think his audience should read this book, because it reveals a consequential figure, not only for Democrats, but for Republicans. And I think Ailes is trying to do his best to make sure conservatives don't see the book.
Excellent. Well, thank you both. And thank you all. Thank you.